Thank you very much. I am really honored to be here today because you're here because you care about ideas. And it is a great honor to share ideas with folks like you. It's also a really big responsibility for me and Jill and our team because the hoverboard is a connection to you guys. It's why you came here today, and we're glad you did. That's not what I want to talk about, hoverboards. Google X worked very long and hard, well, for a couple weeks anyway, to try and come up with a hoverboard until they decided there wasn't the social need for a hoverboard, and they want to do big, good things. And their mission is, it's just and it's honorable. But they stopped work because a hoverboard just wasn't worth it. We started from a different position. I'm not a scientist. I'm an architect. I build things. And I've been working for about 20 years on figuring out a better way to build to protect structures in areas subject to earthquakes and floods, rising sea levels. In July of this year, we had a patent issue. It is essentially for what is a three-part foundation system. And that foundation system is a low-tech solution for building safely in these areas. Now, it's very simple. There's a containment vessel, a buffer medium, and a construction platform. And that buffer medium, it can be water, bay water, it can be a gas. Why not an electromagnetic field? If you can levitate a 50,000 kilogram train, why not a house? Good question. So I started investigating all the existing technology for how to hover stuff. And it turns out that there is no good way to levitate a dynamic load in a stationary position. Yes, there's maglev trains. The state-of-the-art train going in Japan that will be operational in 2027 at a cost of $500 million a mile doesn't levitate unless it's going 170 kilometers an hour. Okay, well, that doesn't work. What I came and what I've settled on studying a little bit is a system called Intitrak. Now, that's the patent up there. There's only one word up there I really want you to take away from this, and that's moving. The patent is for levitating a moving object, a train. So I'm going to share with you the first epiphany we had. If you have a train, and by the way, Dr. Post, he's 95, he's still alive, he's done some amazing work. And I want to just pause for a second and say that Jill and I, Victor Espinosa, one of the early team members, the whole Arx Pax team, we are standing on the shoulders of giants. This couldn't have happened in any other time or place. We are all in an incredibly fortunate position in human history to have at our disposal answers. All we have to do is ask, and the internet's right there. Wikipedia and intuition, that's how we did this. Dr. Post came up with this patent for a moving object. Now, I ask you, and this is the question we asked ourselves, if you have a train and it's levitating, what if that train went in a circle? Now, imagine that train was the same length as the track. It is stationary relative to the Earth as a system. That's the first epiphany, and that might take a while to sink in, but essentially that's what Lawrence Livermore missed. It's that perspective, coming at it from a different angle, not knowing what was supposed to be impossible is possible. And that's why, well, having your attention here is an honor, because I'm hoping to inspire in all of you just that notion that if you approach things just a little bit differently, you can solve problems. That simple step, that connection. Moving object, stationary object, you take that idea and you shrink it down That becomes the essence of a hover engine. But we found some really remarkable things along the way. And this is the first time this information has been shared publicly. There have been some of the, hardcore established scientists can be a little bit offended because we're not following the standard protocols for releasing this kind of information. But hey, we have a hoverboard, so. On the left, you see 20th century description, early, you know, in every physics textbook. That is a bar magnet with some iron filings. And that describes essentially the field lines of a magnet, north and south pole, and the iron filings align. Now, when we started investigating things, one of the first things we did, we sat down and thought about it differently. And so we went and bought a vector Gauss meter, and because it's starting to matter, Gauss is a measurement of magnetic field strength. The Earth, right here, right now, there are 50 Gauss surrounding my hand. 10,000 Gauss is one Tesla. Okay, so using a vector Gauss meter, we were able to measure the magnetic field around a magnet, and by taking into account magnitude and direction, we came up with the digital model on the right. Now again, I'm an architect, so you know these are just data points. You plot them, and that's what you get. What's really amazing is if you talk to some of these wonderful minds that have been attracted by this technology, German physicists who have joined our team, some other really great thinkers. We've got two actual rocket scientists on the team. What's really amazing is they start pulling out this sort of fringe science stuff about magnetic vortices. It's just pretty clear that it's not well understood. So, we have a hoverboard, but that's not what we're going to talk about. The state of the art for seismic design is something called base isolation. Base isolation is the state of the art for seismic design. And what it is, and it's in several buildings around here in the Bay Area, Steve Jobs spent many, many millions of dollars allowing his Pixar studios to move 30 inches laterally. The SFO International Terminals, at a cost of $2 billion, are able to move in an earthquake. So what base isolation really is that it's a kinetic transformer. If you think about an earthquake results at a focal point somewhere in the Earth's crust below the epicenter. When that fault moves, it sends out a compression wave, and that compression wave travels at 1.7 times faster than the secondary S waves. Those are the destructive ones. Those are what cause the damage when that frequency matches the frequency of the building. Now, kinetic transformer. An earthquake shakes very fast, short movements. Base isolation systems, as they exist today, translate that energy into long, slow movements for a building. And that's what removes the force from the structure and allows the building to survive. And here's a big point. The International Building Code sets the standard of construction, not so this building can survive an earthquake, but only so long as it doesn't collapse on its occupants during the event. Otherwise, it's all torn down. The greenest building, LEED Platinum building, the sustainability base at NASA Ames, which we visited recently, if it can't survive an event, an earthquake or a flood, all that embodied energy is lost. It's not green. There's a better way to build, either with a low-tech three-part foundation system or the hover technology. Now, if you can imagine for a moment a building, an operating room, a piece of sensitive equipment, a server rack, that is isolated on essentially its own hoverboard, a hover system that is actuated when we can take advantage of that early warning system on a Hayward fault, which, by the way, the most dangerous fault in the Bay Area now. a 50% chance of a major event in the next 50 years. 50% chance of a major event in the next 50 years. We want to have these structures built, tested, and proven before that event arrives. So, imagine this. The early warning system that exists on the Hayward Fault that right now turns on backup generators for hospitals. It opens the fire doors around the Bay Area to give our firefighters a little head start. But that's about all they can do with that. But those valuable seconds are enough to turn on our hover systems, our hover engines. And once that ground starts shaking, you can imagine the building doesn't lift up. The supports fall away, or the landing gear rises. The ground shakes, the building is hovering above. The ground stops shaking, the supports return, and no one in that room ever knew there was an earthquake. Perfect isolation of that system, of that building. Unlike today's systems, which, by the way, they do save lives, and they're very, very important, but we can do better. In Mexico City, when these base-isolated skyscrapers start shaking, maybe it's a 4.0, but that 4.0 that lasts for 15 seconds, all of a sudden, the whole building's moving for the next 2 minutes. And it's a little disconcerting and causes other issues. If there's no movement, there's a huge, huge opportunity. The underlying technology, though, the magnetic field architecture, which you see based on that new model, a new way of looking at a magnet and its energy, provides a whole host of other opportunities. We have technologies for and provisional patents on omnidirectional elevators. Right now, the limiting factor for an elevator height in a building is the actual mass of the cable. The weight of that cable, that's the limiting factor in how high we can make elevators. Well, if you don't need a cable anymore, all of a sudden things like space elevators become something to talk about. What are some other apps, Jill? Help me out. Automation. Oh, transportation, of course. We are, we've met with the folks who are doing the Hyperloop project. And rather than try to maintain the tolerances using an air bearing system of 0.5 millimeter, we can offer them an inch, a 0.5 inch, and at those speeds, a much, much more robust system. Imagine the HOV lane on the 101, that brand new meaning. While we're improving the conductive surface we need to hover on, for instance, we can hopefully get to a level of efficiency where we can solve the mass transportation last mile challenge. Last mile challenge of mass transportation, it's great for going from A to B, right? But how do you get from your home to point A and then from point B to your final destination? Imagine a new kind of vehicle, a fifth mode of transportation, where you may drive conventionally from your home to point A, hover at almost no energy cost from A to B, and then drive conventionally. We can do that. We can do that. The system out there, the infrastructure, and the folks are concerned, well, you need all this copper, all this aluminum. Well, right now we do. But it's only been a month. We've just gotten started. So whether we can use conductive polymers, carbonaceous concrete, conductive concrete, which now they use in places like Vail or Park City to heat their driveways instead of shoveling them. They just flip a switch. It's all about efficiency. And up until just recently, there wasn't the efficiency to hover a stationary object with a dynamic payload in a stationary position. Putting this technology into your hands so it's not buried by some big corporation, but it's able to solve problems. You know, you can get a hover engine of your own and solve a problem we don't even know exists in a system in manufacturing, clean room technology, particulate generation on wheels in clean rooms is a significant problem. Lubricants. We are working toward a solid state version of this because right now, the hoverboard as it is, it's a little noisy. We haven't incorporated the propulsion controls we know we can do. Since we started this, we've been exposed to a bunch of celebrities and press. But what's really, truly amazing is connecting with people like you who get it. You get it. You understand this is about problem solving. This is about the collective, this triumph of human nature. We built a hoverboard before 2015. We. Our team, I'll tell you some stuff, wasn't planning on mentioning this, but we'll share it. We have a very unique team. Everyone on the team believes. They're not here because of me. They're not here because of Jill or the hoverboard. They're with us because there's a bigger mission. There is real good to be done. Some of the things we can't talk about, but we have the ability now to save lives and property and communities. And I come from a real estate development background as an architect. The single biggest cost on a real estate pro forma is land cost. And I'm hoping that other people will understand this, developers, we can get this message out. That's why this is a responsibility for us. Getting this message out that there is a better way to build. There's a better way to do a lot of things. And we have to keep pushing to find out what those answers are. Advice to you, advice I wish I had heard at any time before I was 45. Find out what you love. Find out who you love. And then follow it with all your heart. Thank you very much.